to cry. Is it just me? Okay, I thought it was just me. That was a beautiful film. Very, very touching. So, so eat, and it's okay to be loud because we'll just talk louder. But we're just going to have a conversation and kind of talk a little bit about, you know, reacting to some of the themes that we saw in the film. Talking about sustainable agriculture and how important that is, and local farming, and you'll hear from really neat examples of people who are know a lot about that subject. So my name is Laura Phillips, and I work at Walmart. I lead all of our work in global sustainability, and so I get to work on this stuff all the time, and it's a privilege. It is an absolute privilege to work on these issues at Walmart. At Walmart, we care deeply about the food system. As you guys may know, some of you, that we are the largest grocer in the U.S., and we take that responsibility really seriously. Our vision is to provide food that's safe, affordable, healthy, great quality, and sustainable to people in all markets that we serve. And again, we know that if we do that, we'll not only be able to really feed the world in a real way, but also to make sure that we are doing that in a way that is sustaining people and the planet. And that's really important to us, and that's kind of our principle in how we think about what we're doing in the food system. And we know the food system has a lot of challenges, you know, as we were kind of seeing today. So at Walmart, we're trying to work on those, you know, working end to end across a lot of different areas. We're trying to lower our environmental impact in the food system. So emissions turns out to be a really big challenge in the food sector. We're working with all of our suppliers on lowering emissions, in particular in agriculture, through a program we call Project Gigaton. If you haven't heard about it yet, Google it. It's pretty cool. There's a ton of information on it.
We've got about 1,000. That's right. I said I would talk louder. So, Patrick. Okay, cool. We've got 1,000 suppliers.
Megan, we got it. We've got 1,000 suppliers in that, and so in our sustainable ag pillar of Project Gigaton, we're working on things like fertilizer optimization, manure management, things that are, you know, emission intensive to try and reduce that. We're working with farmers in the Midwest on row crops. That's also a real challenging area, and looking at things like you saw in the film, cover crops and soil health, and really trying to explore new ways in that supply chain. We're also doing a lot of work with people in our supply chain. Local is really important, as you'll meet a great local supplier in a minute that we're working with. We have a commitment to source locally in all of our markets, and in particular in the U.S., we're really focused on the produce category and increasing our spend of local produce in that category. We also work with smallholders globally and make sure that we're providing great markets for their product. And we're trying to source more sustainably across all of our commodities, you know, the more complex ones. But, you know, I tell you, we know that's not enough. And the theme that I was really touched on in the movie was we're trying to lower environmental impact, but really the next challenge is regenerative and thinking about what does that mean, you know, biodiversity, ecosystems, soil health. And I would say that's kind of the future. We're spending a lot of time thinking about those topics now and how we can embed those more regenerative principles into the food system at Walmart. So more to come, more to do, and it's going to be great to hear from you guys that are doing a lot of the work. So why don't you guys take a minute, introduce yourselves, and then we'll get into some questions and keep eating. And if you want to get more, you can go up, get down, come back, we'll make it real casual.
So I actually will brag on, well, I'm not a Walmart person at all. My name is Patrick Boltzmann. I'm the CEO and founder of Food Maven. And again, we're so glad that you're here tonight. I just, if you live in Bentonville, you probably know this. If you don't, there's a good chance that you aren't aware of this. But Walmart is really, I mean, head and shoulders ahead of the rest of the grocery industry on sustainability and really influencing the system. So, I mean, it's been great to get to know Laura and her team, but I always am kind of amazed that people don't think of Walmart and the most enlightened sustainable practices around food. But I just felt like, you know, as a person from outside, I needed to call that out. And by the way, that's recognized by folks in the industry that do scoring and grading. It just somehow hasn't gotten kind of widely recognized. So I'm Patrick Boltzma. I'm the CEO, founder of Food Maven. And I'll tell you a little more about my background. I'm a farm kid, so came from an ag background, and then a little bit later I'll tell you a little bit more about Food Maven as well, but very passionate about being good stewards of food. And so kind of our our kind of catchphrase or vision is to make sure that all food gets used with good purpose. And a lot of our focus has really been around everything that gets lost and how can we be kind of better stewards as a complement. And again, recognizing that whether it's farmers or across the system, people want to be good stewards. It's just trying to help address some of the challenges in the food system as it exists to be better stewards of food. And I'll tell you a little bit more about that, a little bit more about my background after I have a chance to introduce other folks. I am going to preempt one little piece. So we heard the description of, and by the way, if you're a farmer and you're here, could you show hands? Great. Yeah. So the statement was made that that's what farmers look like in Arkansas. This is what farmers look like in Colorado.
My name is Marcel Vigneron. First and foremost, I'm a cook. I'm a chef. I'm a nurturer by nature, and I love to feed people. I love to bring experiences to people and just kind of enjoy the look on their face, you know, when they're enjoying something. It's something that I've sort of gravitated to since I was a child, I think, and something that fulfills me and drives me to do what I do when I do what I do, which is work hard, a lot. I am the chef owner of Wolf in Los Angeles and Tacos Lobos, which are a couple of restaurants, and we also do a lot of large events and caterings. So events like Stagecoach or Coachella or Summit, and just large, build-in, build-out events where we just feed massive quantities of people in a short amount of time. And that's pretty much me and what I do, and a little bit of background about myself. I'm based out of Los Angeles.
I'm Amber Strohauer, and I'm a fourth-generation potato farmer. My family started growing potatoes back in 1901 in Greeley. It's about an hour north of Denver. And watching the film today was actually really cool because there were parts of it that really reminded me of my childhood. I was really fortunate. My grandpa was in cattle, my aunt trained horses, and then with our family, so everything, you know, you're kind of roaming out in the field. I used to actually take my siblings out on a four-wheeler and we'd go dig up sugar beets and just sit there and eat them. That was one of my favorite things. So it was kind of cool to see something like that and get to see another child grow up that way. But we mainly grow potatoes and onions, and we grow in Colorado, Texas, New Mexico, and Oklahoma. And I did want to mention, we've been working with Food Maven now a little over 2 years. It's been a really cool partnership to watch. And Walmart, for us this year, was amazing. We decided to try and grow watermelons and pumpkins for the first time. And they ended up being a local partner for us and buying them in the Texas DCs. So that was really cool.
That's awesome. All right.
Yeah, thank you.
So maybe let's just stay on the theme of the film and just, you know, get different reactions. Maybe Amber, maybe I can start back with you. You know, so some of the themes that we were seeing in the film, some of the challenges that Molly and John were experiencing on their farm. Maybe just talk about from your perspective, what are the challenges that you're seeing and how are you kind of trying to balance, you know, bringing in more sustainable practices, also meeting the yields that you're needing to make sure that you're having a successful business. So maybe just start with you, and then maybe, you know, kick that same question over to Marcel, Patrick.
Well, we've been growing organic since 2006, and watching that film and you're seeing this ecosystem interact with their crops, I think that's something that the public doesn't understand a lot of times. To be certified organic, you can't actually have those animals roaming in the field. And so, you know, in our farm in Texas, occasionally we'll see like a wild bear or, you know, a deer roaming through, and that's actually a violation on being allowed to be organic that year. And it's a big process to be organic. You know, it takes 3 years of growing that way. Before you're recognized, and so then to have something like that happen is a big deal. Also, we're growing in areas that are a little different than California. we don't quite have as long of a growing season, so those yields are really important. But I think our approach is kind of in reverse of what you saw today, because we do a lot of the same things from a more, you know, large scale perspective. Right now, even on our conventional potatoes and onions, we're using organic organic approved compounds, your herbicides, your pesticides, about 65% on our conventional. So there's a huge transition for most growers across the nation to finding these organic compounds being more effective. And those are actually like, we're putting fungi, and we have a product called Bunch of Bugs. So it is, you know, the fungi and bacteria that we're putting back in the soil. I think there's a misconception that farmers are ruining the land, but at the end of the day, that is our most valuable asset, and that is what we're constantly thinking about. There's just so many things outside of your control, and you put in all this effort to have one bad hailstorm just completely annihilate you. So that's a challenge, and then you have water regulations coming in. Colorado, water is probably the biggest headache for any farmers in that area. And like where we're going right now, we're still not allowed to pump a lot of our wells. They're still really trying to consolidate water. But it's even becoming problematic because the water table now has risen so high that we have such a high level of nitrogen in the soil. So even where you think you're doing a good thing, just as you saw in the movie, it's just constant battles. You think you do one good thing and then you backtrack and you gotta take steps forward. So I feel like farmers have to be extremely optimistic to the point of crazy. Just try not to cross that line. So yeah, that's kind of what we're doing.
I would say from a chef perspective, one of the sort of difficulties that I find within sourcing is like a moral obligation to the customer, but also an obligation to myself and to my craft, to sort of like create, you know, the highest level of food that's going to be consumed by my guests, right? Because when you think about it, like as a chef, it's an extremely intimate occupation, right? Like what we do, you know, directly goes into your body, and you turn it into like sustenance and energy, so you can go throughout your day. And so, I mean, there isn't really anything like, maybe there's a couple things as intimate as that, but there's not really a lot of things that I can think of that reach that level. And so, when you take that into consideration, I feel like you do have this like massive obligation to source, you know, the highest quality ingredients, you know, for your guests. So that way, you know, they have premium octane or to do whatever they have to do. But at the same time, you know, as a chef, you have, you know, your business obligations. You know, you have your investors and you have your food cost percentages and you have, you know, your black lines and your red lines, and the dollars have to make sense at the end of the day. So you can't just like, you know, buy the most incredible, you know, organic asparagus and sell it for, you know, $40 a plate if you're, you know, not in an economic community that can sustain that sort of, you know, price point. So I think finding balance within that and within your community and within your establishment is a difficulty. And then also, I would say, you know, sustainability from the perspective of, okay, like, if I'm doing a music festival for 100,000 people, you know, am I going to just, like, wipe out this farm's, like, entire crop? You know what I mean? Am I going to be able to get enough of that organic asparagus to feed all of these people? And, like, within that, you know, there are challenges, without a doubt, not to mention the economic impact that also has. But I think that, like, you know, finding that sort of balance, and this goes back to that saying, like, where there's a will, you know what I mean, there's a way, and it takes a lot of, like, research, it takes a lot of, you know, connections with the right people, it takes a lot of know-how and experience, you know what I mean, and having, like, been through that before, and so like realizing, okay, like how are we going to combat, you know, this particular challenge before it arises? You know, I mean, how are we going to set these systems in place so that way when we, you know, when this hurdle comes at us, you know, we can tackle it or whatever. And just so being able to sort of like overcome those challenges through knowledge, through experiences, and through your community is one of the most important ways to sort of like overcome those hurdles. But yeah, I would say I feel like that was the point, right?
It was a great question.
So I really appreciated the film. I think in part because increasingly we live in a society that doesn't even know a farmer. You know, I grew up in a town of 250 people. Fourth generation farm family, but actually that's only because of immigration. I can't trace back far enough in my family tree to kind of find members that weren't farmers. So I mean that's what I grew up in knowing. And I grew up, I think one of the misconceptions that I, you know, will hear many times is people don't realize that farmers are really the original conservationists. You know, I cannot tell you how many times my grandfather would say to me, you know, if we care for the land, it will care for us. You know, it's just, it was a real sense of kind of virtue. And, you know, you had a sense that you were doing something that really was honorable and noble in growing food to feed people. You know, in the era of the founding of our country, 92% of people were involved in agriculture. We just dropped to a point where less than 0.5%. Farmers are, right now there's 10 times more farmers over 55 than under 35. Farmers over 72 outnumber 5-1 farmers under 30. So, you know, we're really getting to a point where, and the nature of the capital intensity and the challenges, it's really tough to get into agriculture. If you're not born in a family farming tradition, it's virtually impossible. And I think, you know, part of what I really appreciated about the film is, you know, I mean, there's an element of that I kind of go, kind of romanticized. Like, I wonder who put up all that cash. And I really wonder about the economics of when did they actually hit break-even, or are they even at break-even yet? And so there's so much that I really value and respect, but I think most of all I appreciate that if it can reawaken awareness for farmers in our society, and a thoughtfulness around where our food comes from, that's, I think, the most profound thing that I took away from the film.
Yeah, that's great. I love those themes, balance and focus on farmers and kind of those challenges that you talked about, Amber. So maybe just take the broader topic of, you know, kind of this challenge of the modern food system and being able to produce enough, you know, volume for the economics and to really feed the demand for what we need, and then also that challenge of sustainability. So any thoughts from where you sit in the food system of, you know, what are things you're optimistic about as we're seeing those tensions play out, or innovations in sustainability, or what are some thoughts that you have, you know, that gives you optimism around some of the challenges?
System that really, well, first of all, let me say, farmers are struggling to make it. And that's just the reality, right? So the USDA number, they just revised up. 70% of farmers, the USDA estimates, are in what they call the economic red zone, which really means they're one bad crop cycle from serious financial trouble. So with the floods in Nebraska, the estimate is up to a third of farmers could go bankrupt just on that one event. So I think sometimes we kind of think, oh, well, farmers would just do things different, but it's really a bigger system issue. So to give an example, corn. Any guess what percentage of corn grown by U.S. farmers is eaten by us in a form that looks like corn? 1%. So 40% of corn produced in the United States goes to ethanol, 36% goes to animal feed, 13% goes to high fructose corn syrup, which that will kill you, and then about 10% is highly processed into what looks like, if you read the food label, it looks like a chemistry experiment. Those ingredients are probably some derivative from corn. Now, that's not because farmers want to grow corn to not feed people, but they're caught in a system. So I think, you know, I think some of what needs to happen at the society level is understanding that we got to do things to help farmers get to kind of where they candidly want to be as well. And again, it's transforming the system. Now, the encouraging thing is I think increasingly consumers, even in the grocery, like the edge of the store is what's growing, right? It's fresh, it's more whole products, it's, you know, so there is a growing kind of awareness, but there's some big system transformations that need to occur, and we can't put those burdens on farmers. So as a society and the consumer preferences and folks, you know, some of the things that Walmart's doing around sustainability, those are creating very positive pull through. But there's also kind of our job of what we do with our pocketbook to really kind of enable, to vote with, you know, the economics to really enable farmers to do what they really want to do, which is grow food to feed people.
I'd like to touch on that point as well and just discuss like the importance of sort of like sourcing locally, right? Because I feel like that's something that in our sort of like supermarket society these days, it's so easy for us to get away from. You know, it's like, I can remember seeing the first time I lifted up a chicken and there was a kid there who saw like the egg underneath it and was like, what? Like that's where eggs come from? They don't come from the carton inside of the grocery store? Or, you know, my own sort of like personal memories of going into my uncle's farm and going into the chicken coop and getting pecked by the rooster. I don't think it was greasy, but you know, and just seeing that sort of like closeness to food where it was like I took the chicken in and then next thing you know, my grandma was like snapping the neck and plucking the feathers and like doing the whole thing. And I was like, oh man, like that's dinner, you know, and having that sort of like closeness to your food and knowing where your food comes from and that realization that, you know, it's not just, you know, a chicken breast that's wrapped in cellophane in some sort of foil container that you get off of a shelf. You know, and it that thing was a living animal at one time. And I think that like our sort of society has moved so far away from that sort of connection with our food, and that sort of like connection with your food is extremely important. You know what I mean? Because then you're like realizing maybe you consume like a little bit less poultry, a little bit more vegetables, and maybe you're a little bit more thankful for that poultry or whatever the case may be. But then when you look at like the greater, like the bigger picture of things, and you look at the importance of sourcing locally, there's all these other like global impacting factors. Like for example, you know, what's the carbon footprint on, you know, on that truck that took those tomatoes, you know, that were picked when they were green in California and driven, you know, to New York or whatever, and then, you know, thrown into a room full of gas. And then, you know, made to ripen, you know, 2 days prior because you can't ship a ripe tomato because it'll bruise. And the green tomatoes are nice and hard, so you can toss them around in their cases and they can sit in semis and whatever. But when you actually get that tomato at the grocery store in New York that was from California like 3 weeks earlier and then, you know, living in a room full of gas, it doesn't smell like a tomato, you know what I mean? It doesn't feel like a tomato. And I think there's some sort of connection between deliciousness and nutritiousness where it's almost synonymous. So follow me, where it's like, if it walks like a duck, it talks like a duck, it's obviously a duck. But like, if the strawberry like looks like a strawberry and smells like a strawberry and tastes like a strawberry, it's probably a strawberry. Whereas if it like looks like a strawberry, doesn't smell like a strawberry, doesn't taste like a strawberry, it tastes more like maybe like a watermelon or something. It's like, is that really a strawberry? You know, or was it something that was grown somewhere else in a land far, far away that, you know, lost its nutrition, it lost its identity. It may look like a strawberry, but really it's not giving you those nutrients, it's not giving you those chemicals, and it's not really that ingredient anymore. But when you source something that's locally, not only are you decreasing that global, you know, that carbon footprint impact of all the emissions and, you know, the trucks and, you know, the so on and so forth, you're also supporting your local economy, right? Which is like, there's nothing more important than that if, you know, if you're in that community, than supporting your local community and knowing that those dollars that you're giving to that farmer that lives down the street are going to be pumped back into your own, you know, town. And that in and of itself is gold. You know, I mean, that's priceless. Not to mention the fact that like you're buying a product that was harvested when it was ripe. You know what I mean? So that tomato you bought from that farmer down the street, he harvested that tomato when it was ripe. you know, and then you're going to feed that to yourself or your children, your family, your loved ones, or whatever. And then that, again, is going to go into your body and provide you with the nutrients and the sustenance that you need to go throughout your day. So again, there's like all these like multifaceted, important, like impactful, you know, things that are happening when we're making this decision on whether like, well, do I buy the organic tomato or do I buy the conventional tomato? Like, I don't know if I have time to go to the farmer's market this week. I got to pick up the kids from school or whatever it is, you know, and it's like, it's very difficult to make the right decision, and it's not easy to make the right decision. And if anything, in our society, it's easier to go the other way, and it's cheaper to go the other way. And so I think at the end of the day, it's difficult, but through movies like The Biggest Little Farm, you know, we're educating the consumer, we're educating ourselves, and we're coming to that progressive realization that like the harder choice oftentimes is going to be the better choice. You know, and the more important choice for ourselves, for our future generations, you know, for the farmer, for the consumer, for the seller, for all parties involved. Yep.
Yeah, the hardest choice probably being the better choice. For me, that film was so inspiring, and I mean, it's beautifully done. I think there's a place for everybody in a sense, and it helps balance us out. I think in the film they said it was about 200 acres that they were working on. To kind of put that in perspective, with us, usually our irrigated fields average about 125 acres. So we actually need enough volume in order to be super efficient, and by being able to, like Walmart with the watermelon partnership. That was huge for us because if we hadn't had a market where we know we can move a lot of product to, we wouldn't have been able to afford the technology to where on that 125 acres, we're actually monitoring it in 2.5 acre chunks. So we're only putting on what it needs in each of those areas, and we go up precision agriculture is kind of what they call it. But even from a moisture standpoint, we have moisture sensing probes, and every 10 minutes we're getting updates, and they're allowing us to make sure we're not oversaturating and not, you know, we're utilizing everything and not going overboard. And the same can be said, John Deere tractors nowadays. It's crazy. I can pull up an app and see where exactly someone is and if their fuel, if they're, you can look at fuel usage, you can see if their tractor's stalling, and I mean, the technology out there nowadays is just amazing and incredible, and I don't feel like we would be as efficient and being able to support our current system if we didn't have that type of volume. So I think seeing something like that was a nice way to kind of remind you, you know, us as a farm of where can we do better, and where can we partner with people to really make sure we're moving in the right direction. But then at the same time, it does have to be profitable. It does have to be something that can support. We feel like farming is this amazing, purposeful, I'm very passionate about it, and I love what I get to do. But what keeps me going during those hard times is most of our team has been with us since I was 10 years old. They watched me grow up. This is what they know, and when you know, this is our community, it is our family. And so even when it comes to specializing in a produce and maybe not growing 75 different stone fruits, it's important because, you know, our team's been sorting potatoes since I was 10 years old from a quality standpoint, and just kind of knowing the ins and outs of a potato, there's just no comparison there. So I think there's a place for everything, and it's us all working together at the end of the day.
All right, and we're a little bit over. Maybe just one last, like, lightning round question. So, that's okay. You guys okay? Get your dessert. There's lots of good food. So, there's extra wine, I hear. So maybe just from, you know, from Strohauer Farm, for Wolf, for Food Maven, like just kind of what are you excited about with your business? Like just talk about your business and what's next and what are you really excited about? So maybe start back.
Yeah.
Well, I'm really excited about actually this partnership with Food Maven. For our operation, we're constantly, sadly, you know, in a way, not throwing out good potatoes, but they're going to cattle feed and just ways that, you know, they're not being utilized to the fullest. And so really figuring out ways, not only can we have a market for that, but how can we collect that better? I don't know if you've ever seen like a harvested field, but usually there's a ton of product still left in the field that isn't collected by a harvester. And so it's finding ways to utilize that sort of thing from a sustainability standpoint, and then when we're sorting out, and also just from a storing product and kind of what we were talking about local. We, being in Colorado, have a short season, and so moving that product into market super quickly and just relying on a few months of really selling product comes to having amazing partnerships, because that's a lot of volume. And what I try to remind myself every day is what I feel like we're good at is farming, and I want to keep us in that. And so it's trying to build partnerships that allow you to have people that are better at figuring out logistics, figuring out how we can be in more markets, and kind of relying and working together on that. So really excited about continuing to push ourselves in that regard.
I concur. I'm actually really excited to continue to foster these relationships with Laura and Patrick and Amber. I don't know if anybody here has been to Wolf before, but one of my most notable famous dishes is our crispy potatoes with ají amarillo alioli. Ali. So when I found out Amber was a potato farmer, I was like, wow, oh, that's incredible. So really excited to work with our potatoes. But also with Patrick and all of Food Maven's work with food waste has been something that has always affected me as a chef. We do, you know, large scale events, and oftentimes there could be leftover product or whatever the case may be, and you know, finding a utilization and finding like a home for that leftover, you know, produce that's still perfectly capable. And oftentimes, you know, we're delivering stuff to food banks and things like that. But I think that they're, you know, working with Patrick gives us the opportunity to sort of expand that capability and introduce him into some, you know, some more relationships with some of these larger festivals, which is extremely exciting for me, and just fulfilling to be a connector of dots, you know, because one of, I think, the most disappointing things for me is seeing like the lack of infrastructure that exists and how difficult it is for somebody like myself, who's like the small, like independent mom and pop shop, that like when I want to do the right thing, it's difficult for me to do so because there is no infrastructure. You know, there is no sort of like solution for me to like donate this product or whatever. And then when I will go to like the heads and they're like, oh yeah, we don't really have a plan for that. And it's like, oh, okay, well, I'll take care of it personally. But then I like will turn to other vendors and they're just like, oh yeah, we don't even know what we're gonna do with our leftover potato or whatever it is. And so just like as a chef and as a nurturer and just like a conscious human being, like, you know, and knowing what our society is facing with people, you know, that don't have food, and so to be like throwing food away, it just like doesn't really like, I mean, you know, doesn't really make any sense. So through that education and through those connections, through those relationships and that knowledge, you know, comes responsibility and power. And facing those responsibilities is what I'm really, really excited about, and growing these relationships. And then even just educating people. I was actually in the desert in Indio, and I was with a couple chefs, and we were buying a couple super soakers and a kiddie pool for Stagecoach, and a couple movies. And we're cruising through, and I was like, man, let's get some produce for the RV. I was like, I'm feeling kind of hungry. And one of the other chefs who remained nameless was like, I'm not buying produce from Walmart. And I was like, bro, like, let's check it out. Let's peruse these aisles. You know what I mean? Like, you know, don't knock it till you try it. And we're cruising through, and I was like, smells like cauliflower, bro. It's baby farts for sure, you know? And I'm like, I'm very tactile shopper. And we found some incredible stuff. And I bought all this food, took it back to the RV, and we cooked it. And, you know, I converted this this phenomenal chef who was like, wait, what? Like, we just got all this, like, incredible product from Walmart. And just for us, like, being small, like, you know, independent chefs, we're you know, very small farmers, and, you know, we're, like, you know, we have our own, you know, whatever. But so, it was very cool and very eye-opening. So I look forward to working with you more as well in the near future. And doing fun stuff like this. And thank you, everyone, for being here at the Biggest Little Farm. I mean, that was just, it's just a pleasure and an honor to be here. So thank you.
And I should probably just give you a very brief what we do. And what I'm really excited about. So Food Maven, our real focus is on just how much gets lost in the food system. So the estimate is 40% of everything farmers grow is thrown away, hundreds of billions of dollars of loss, and, you know, again, the whole food system is not really making a lot of money. So, you know, our focus was really to say, how could we address that? And again, you know, we feed our dogs better than 40-some million Americans and all kinds of direct as well as indirect environmental issues around all that waste and loss. So Food Maven, we're really seeking to be a complement and to partner with the food system to be able to understand how that food gets lost, how we can intervene, and then make a market for that. And have had tremendous kind of growth. I think the thing that I'm most grateful for, Walmart and others have been great about kind of leaning in with us. One of the ways that food really gets lost is with local farmers. It's not at all unusual for number two potatoes to not be available, or for a retailer to think something's going to be in big demand and a grower produces it and it's not in demand, and now they got a lot of inventory on their hands. So we are working very directly with kind of farmers, as food producers, as well as kind of the big grocery system to be able to get that product and make a home. Now I will tell you, and again, we're a for-profit business, but focused on improving the situation for people who make and grow our food. About 20 to 25% of what comes into our system we take to donation. And so we're dramatically increasing what goes to donation. And again, just crazy that anybody wouldn't have enough when we're throwing away so much. And then we are in a zero landfill. We're always looking for more environmentally and economically enlightened alternatives than throwing food away. The thing that has really been the shift that's occurred since we got started with Food Maven is that all of the awareness around sustainability and increased social responsibility. And particularly we're seeing that, I mean, it's already been there with Walmart and others, but we're seeing it now with big food service. So we announced a strategic partnership and relationship with Hilton Hotels. We have Sodexo, Bon Appetit, all leaning in, and the ability to actually move things, to be able to address local farmers with product loss or the food system with product loss, and being able to get it into good use at substantial volume. And the fact that our society increasingly cares is one of the things that's most encouraging. It's been a very positive business driver. I thought we would have our values, but everybody else would be coin operated. And to see that kind of thing that I find most encouraging. And I really think both with the consumer kind of growing awareness and interest in farmers and where food comes from, and some of these more really enlightened practices, that we really do have the real prospect of making sure that all food gets used with good purpose. And that's really encouraging to me.
Well, thanks so much, Arsia. I'm excited about working with all of you guys. Amber, you know, at Walmart, we want to sell more of your great produce. So keep it up. We look forward to buying from you. And Marcel, I'm glad we've converted your friend. And hopefully we can sell some of our produce to your customers. We're from our Sam's Club or Walmart's. And Patrick, we really enjoy the partnership with Food Maven. We're really looking forward to you continuing to grow. And really the niche and the need that you're serving is outstanding. So. With that, I think we'll wrap it up. I hope you guys enjoyed the conversation I did. But, you know, if your day jobs don't work out, you guys could all, you know, be on the circuit on your own shows or something. You're terrific. So, hope you guys enjoyed the discussion. Thank you for coming out. Thank you for the film. And hopefully you're taking away some new things tonight and some new thoughts and, you know, new ideas kind of turning in your head about what we can all do together in the food system to really ensure that we are providing a sustainable food supply for the future. So, good. good to see you guys. Hope to see you at other film festival events through the weekend. Hopefully you're staying around and it'll be a fun weekend. And the weather hopefully gets better. But if not, we'll still have fun. So thank you guys.